Welcome to the Lighting University Light Bite series on light for public space. Today we're going to explore several remarkable lighting projects around the world that showcase the new possibilities for urban lighting in public space. In this first part of our three-part series, we'll review six key trends that are transforming light in public space. We reviewed more than 100 different projects around the world in mixed-use environments that allowed us to revisit some of the assumptions that we hold about light in public space. You can see here a list of some of the projects that we'll talk about today in part one. The five different assumptions that I want to revisit with you all today are things that relate to how we design for public space. The first one has to do with our assumption that everyone moves around the city by car. The role of the car in the second half of the 20th century was really essential for the design of cities, but today we're seeing a much more diverse set of urban forms coming into being. The second theme has to do with the question of uniformity, which is an essential one for lighting and absolutely an important goal when designing a public space. However, when we only focus on uniformity, places become bland and generic. The third goal, or the third theme, has to do with this assumption that all artificial lighting comes from above in the evening. The fourth one has to do with the idea that more is always better and brighter is always better, and has to do with questions of contrast and balance in spaces. And the last one has to do with questions of diversity, and diversity in terms of citizen needs, but also diversity in terms of environments and architecture that make places unique and memorable. So let's have a look at these five themes first, and then we'll summarize in a last theme. The first topic, again, focuses on questions of cities viewed from the car. This is a famous movie, a screenshot here from Jim Jarmusch's Night on Earth, a really iconic movie about nighttime in the city as viewed from a vehicle. Here you can see one of the iconic scenes from Times Square in New York City. While the city is still very car-centric in many places, and while we still depend a great deal on personal vehicles, what is really happening in cities all around the world, from large cities to small cities, is a trend towards much more diverse types of modes and transportation that really lead to something that is more of a pedestrian-centric environment, or an environment that focuses on people. Here is a project by the artist Ivan Toth de Pena that he created for a government building in Miami, where his interactive light pillars create a kind of an interactive memory of people's presence in the space. As they walk in front of these lit columns, their portrait, in a way, is taken as a heat map. So these vertical panels create a history wall of people's presence and of people's activity. It creates an inviting experience for people as they enter the building and transition from their car or their bicycle into a pedestrian zone that then takes them on to the different government offices. This kind of example is really how people-centric lighting might start to play a role in public spaces and environments. Shifting scales a little bit in the same topic is this example from the Media Lab Prado in Madrid, Spain. The urban screen here that is shown is really an extraordinary example of something that you might find more in Times Square. However, here the designers have created something that is also functional at the intimate pedestrian level. And this Media Lab Prado uses the facade to communicate with citizens and to actually create an interactive space. So different designers at different times of the year create different types of artworks that are then displayed on the facade, giving it a real civic importance and a civic meaning, going far beyond something that might just focus on advertising or straight up information display. So the architects, Langarita Navarro, really worked closely with the building and with the institution to create something that would be a flexible and civic infrastructure that functions at multiple scales. Summing up this section, let's take a look at Nancy Clanton's quote here. Too often, we still think of public lighting's role as allowing motorists to detect pedestrians. Walking pedestrians are more vulnerable. Where they look, what they need in a lighted environment is completely different from motorists. So really taking into account this experience of people in the city on different diverse modes of transportation coming together to experience place in a memorable and lasting way. The second topic was around uniformity. And like we said early on, uniformity is still an essential quality for urban environments when it comes to lighting. We need to create spaces that people feel are lit in a way that is even and allows them to really navigate space easily. However, when it comes to different kinds of spaces, we can also talk about careful curation of nightscapes. So rather than thinking about uniformity as something that is the only goal, we can start to apply lessons from indoor lighting, for example, around layering and layering different elements of light to create something that feels like an actual lightscape rather than simply a uniform lit environment. Here's an example of City Hall Plaza in Sant Cugat del Vallès near Barcelona, done by Artec 3, Spanish lighting and product design group. What they looked at here with these custom light fixtures that emit two different layers of light is really extraordinary. You can see both a uniform level of lighting that allows people to easily navigate the space, and a secondary layer of lighting with color that speaks to the seasonal change in the city and actually captures that seasonal change through the different colors that are displayed on the ground. Over the course of this longitudinal space, there's additional urban furniture elements that also have lit components in them. And together, they've created a real lightscape that allows people to have a lasting memory of nighttime in their City Hall Plaza. Moving on to the third theme that is more focused on this question of contrast. So, along the lines of curation, there's another essential characteristic that we have to consider. And this has to do with how multiple layers of lighting together may overlap to become too bright over time. So here is an example of how in Riedberg, Germany, Jochen Meyer Brandis created different layers of contrast with different color temperatures of warm and cool white light to really set off this architectural icon of the downtown area. Through the different layers of light, the city was able to reset, as it were, the light levels in their central district and give people a new impression of this historic building of the church of the Central Plaza. People are now able to navigate through the space in a way that is much more comfortable and also much more dramatic in many ways, allowing them to truly appreciate the experience of the nighttime city. So lighting now is becoming an element in the environment that allows the architectural spaces to really shine at the same time as it's providing useful information for navigation and wayfinding, since we know more and more how important vertical illumination is for people's perception of space and for their ability to find their way in the city. Moving on to the next theme, we're heading towards this question of light from above. So, since light from above is something that we take for granted during the day, given that the sun lights spaces from above, there's an assumption sometimes that in the evening, we also want to recreate that very same feeling. In the early 20th century, late 19th century, some of the very impressive tower lights that were envisioned are an example of what might happen when you actually take this to the extreme. Here are some examples of tower lights from the US and others from Europe where they were just envisioned but not implemented. Unlike, for example, in Austin, Texas, where they're still in place and really historic monuments at this point. So even though this was an interesting vision and idea, in many ways, the transition towards LED lighting and solid-state digital lighting technologies has enabled us to think of light as a source, as a material for building that allows us to really think about light as something that envelops us. So unlike in the past, where light sources were more difficult to tame. Today, we have the ability to integrate LED lighting in many different ways with building materials. Just like here, the landscape architecture firm Planet Earth collaborated with Light Lab to create a unique plaza at the University of the Arts near the Tate Britain in London. So these light strips integrated into the ground are able to create a unique experience that reflects the artistic practices that are being taught in the buildings nearby. So the actual geometries shown are related to different types of drawing techniques, different types of analytical drawing techniques. And so together, this design allows us to both reflect the value of the place, but also to create a unique experience that envelops people as they travel across this plaza. Again, working at multiple levels and multiple scales, so allowing people to both have a unique experience close up, but also creating a very distinct visual impression for the people looking down from the buildings nearby in the offices and in the classrooms. In the final theme that I mentioned early on, we're thinking about diversity. So this question that is really important to us about being able to find the single common denominator in order to create an environment for all is really a challenging one. And in many ways, the more we learn about how people's vision changes over the course of their life, we have to think about different ways to celebrate diversity in our lit environment. In this example of the Crown Fountain in Millennium Park in Chicago, artist Helme Plensa collaborated with Crook & Sexton architects and Schuller Shook lighting designers to create a really unique fountain that reflects the diversity of Chicagoans. You can see here the two faces of two different Chicagoans in the front of these lit towers that are actually fountains that shoot water onto the plaza in the center between the two faces as they talk to each other, as it were. So this project, now almost more than 10 years old, still is one of the best examples of an iconic urban plaza that takes on a special meaning during the day and during the night through its reflection of the diversity of the city and its population. So since we already went through our five themes, I decided to add a sixth one here that summarizes some of these ideas. And I'm borrowing a term here from the urban sociologist Richard Sennett, who's based at the London School of Economics and New York University, when he refers to something called the brittle city. Here's an image from a famous film by Jacques Tati, Playtime, that illustrates what happens in a very specifically organized city, a modernist city, where work and life are separated into specific zones and various transportation infrastructures allow people to navigate between the different zones of the city. This type of organization can sometimes become something that is very fragile, or as Sennett says, brittle, when it leads to an organization that is pushed to the extreme, when things become too large or people have difficulty actually moving between the different resources and neighborhoods of the city. So how do we transition away from this idea of something that is more potentially rationally organized, but something that is more resilient instead? So here's an example of a project that was done by interaction design firm SoSo Limited called Energy of the Nation. They created a giant mood ring of the country for the London Olympics in 2012. Their analysis of Twitter feeds using natural language processing led to a collective mood or sentiment analysis of the entire nation during the Olympic Games. They used these data to create an ambient light show that was played on the London Eye every evening. This show allowed people to get a glimpse from a distance and up close of how the nation was doing, how people were feeling about the Olympics. Were they excited or were they concerned about certain players or certain participants' performance? Additional data projections close to the London Eye then also provided people with more detailed information beyond the simple mood ring feeling. So if we come back to our six themes now, summarizing, you'll see that we transitioned from roadway-centric lighting to light for people and diverse modes of transportation, from uniform lighting to carefully curated lightscapes, from brighter is better to a controlled use of contrast, from overhead lighting to enveloping lighting, and from one size fits all to a celebration of diversity, which together, I argue, these five themes allow us to transition from a brittle city to something that is more resilient in the future. In conclusion, I'd like to leave you with this thought. The role of public lighting moves beyond the perceptual towards the relational. Light mediates between people and the built environment. Thank you very much for listening to part one of our Light Bites series. Please stay tuned for part two on April 9th and part three on April 23rd. I'd also like to acknowledge the projects we showed today in this presentation. And I'd also like to acknowledge all of the people who helped support this work and provided valuable advice and feedback, as well as my co-author, Antonia Weiss.